Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Sue Fletcher-Watson, and welcome to this session on neurodevelopmental diversity. We've got five amazing researchers who are going to be speaking this afternoon in relation to our theme of transdiagnostic research in neurodevelopment. And the session runs until just after 4:30 this afternoon. Please do make it interactive. You can discuss your thoughts with each other in the chat box, but also post questions for our speakers. And feel free to post them as you go along. We will kind of scoop them up at the end of each of the presentations, and I will try and fire as many questions as I've got time for to each speaker so you can hear their thoughts. What do I mean by transdiagnostic research? We're going to hear about that properly in our first talk, but the way I think about this is that transdiagnostic research is any research that aims to explore neurodevelopment in a way that isn't bound by existing diagnostic categories. So perhaps looking at common experiences between different diagnostic groups, dimensions that might predict outcome regardless of diagnostic status, or explorations of variability and co-occurrences within existing clinical groups. If you find that exciting, I'm just going to take a second to shamelessly plug a big conference that we're putting together in Edinburgh and online next year in March 2023 called It Takes All Kinds of Minds, which is themed around neurodiversity across the lifespan. And I'll put the link in the chat so that you can see it later on if you're curious to explore that. But the website is itacom.org. Anyway, you didn't come here to listen to me, and especially not to hear me talk about a completely different conference. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce our first speaker, who is Professor Joni Holmes from the University of East Anglia. And she's delivering our teaching talk on what does a transdiagnostic study look like?
Today, I'd like to talk to you about what a transdiagnostic study looks like. And I'd like to begin by enabling you some time to think about what it is like to be neurodivergent. And to help with this, I'd like to introduce you to three children.
I always get told off, and I just find it really, really hard to concentrate and do everything properly.
English is like harder because in writing and reading, my reading's like not gone really well. And then my writing has improved like a lot since I was in primary school.
So here we met Freddie, Billy, and Eva. Freddie has difficulties paying attention. He's always on the go. In his own words, he can be quite disruptive. He has difficulties in reading and maths, and he has a diagnosis of ADHD. We also met Billy. Now, he also has difficulties paying attention. He's receiving extra support in multiple subjects at school. He finds that he can be easily distracted. He experiences anxiety. Yet despite having these additional needs, he has no diagnosis. And we also met Eva. She has difficulties in reading. She's receiving speech and language therapy, experiences anxiety, finds it hard to pay attention at times, and has a diagnosis of dyslexia. So we can see that the diagnostic status of these three children differs. So does that mean that the reason they have additional needs also differs? How do we start to try to understand children's additional needs and what causes them? Well, our traditional approach would be to use a case-controlled design. In a case-controlled design, we would select our group of interest. So for example, a group of children with ADHD. And we would then select a group to compare them to. This might be a neurotypical group, or it might be a group of children with a different diagnosis. We would most commonly match the groups on some characteristics such as biological sex, age, and IQ. And we would think about what measures are we interested in. So for example, working memory and white matter connectivity. We would collect our data, carry out some analysis, And typically we would use some kind of univariate group comparison to compare white matter connectivity in particular regions of interest or performance on cognitive tasks between our two groups. And then we would look at our results and conclude something like, well, actually, I can see here the children with ADHD are performing more poorly on the working memory tasks than the control group. Therefore, children with ADHD have working memory deficits. And then we might also look at our imaging data and conclude that these are the white matter correlates of ADHD, as this is where I saw patterns of differences between my two groups. Now, this kind of study has been used for many, many years in the literature to try and understand neurodiversity. And there have been some really important breakthrough findings using these approaches. But I'd like us just to step back for a moment to consider some of the challenges of these approaches. So let's first think about our sampling approach. By using case-controlled designs, we are inevitably highly selective. By thinking about trying to include children with a particular diagnosis, for example, we end up using quite strict inclusion criteria. This often results in us having a small sample size, but more importantly, it means that we exclude many children who also have additional needs. So for example, if we're selecting children with ADHD, we might exclude children who have comorbid diagnoses of other difficulties. Or we might exclude children who don't reach our diagnostic thresholds. In other words, we might exclude children who either have milder needs or who have not yet met a professional to make a diagnosis. So what this means is actually that the literature is missing children who have more complex needs, and it's also missing children like Billy who don't have any diagnoses, yet we can see that they clearly do need some support or that they actually do have additional needs that they would like help with. The case-controlled design also carries a number of assumptions that when we think about what it's like to be neurodiverse, don't really hold true. They carry the assumption of within-group homogeneity. So this assumption is that children with a particular diagnosis have the same kinds of needs as one another, the same symptom presentations as one another, and that these arise through the same underlying causes. They also assume cross-group heterogeneity, and this really is the assumption that children with different diagnostic statuses have different needs or different symptom presentations that arise through different causes. Now, if we think back to the children you met at the beginning, we can see that this is not the case, and this will be the case if you've worked with children who have additional needs. So if we think first of all about Freddie and Eva here, we can see Freddie had ADHD, Eva has dyslexia, yet despite having these different diagnoses, there was a lot of overlap in the symptoms that they said they experienced. Both children were finding that they had difficulties in reading, and both children found it hard to pay attention. So how do we start to overcome these challenges? Well, one alternative approach is a transdiagnostic approach. The principles of this alternative approach require us to focus on the characteristics and mechanisms that are associated with neurodiversity and to move away from diagnostic and category-based approaches. So let's just think about that for a moment. Now, our diagnostic approach would assume that we have these distinct disorders and that they have distinct causes and that there is a one-to-one mapping between a cause and a disorder. If we take a transdiagnostic approach, we stop focusing on disorders. We instead will focus on symptoms or needs. And we assume that there is not a one-to-one mapping between a cause and symptom, but we instead assume that a symptom can arise through multiple causes and that there can be interplay between these different causes to give rise to different symptom presentations. In other words, by using a transdiagnostic approach, we try to embrace complexity. So what does a transdiagnostic study look like? Well, in fact, we can use many different study designs to yield transdiagnostic insights. These can range from recruiting by a diagnosis to recruiting by a functional definition or area of need, right through to using unselective recruitment and using population studies. So you might think, well, okay, you've just been telling me about the challenges of using these recruitment by diagnosis approaches. But what we can do is we can actually recruit by diagnostic group, and then abandon that at the point of analysis to try and identify particular abilities that might predict particular outcomes for children, irrespective of diagnostic grouping. In other words, we can actually use multiple case groups and ignore the grouping to try and identify transdiagnostic dimensions. In a moment, I'm going to be talking to you about a particular study where we've used functional definition to try to recruit children to try and understand a bit more about neurodiversity. So I won't spend time explaining that here, but just be aware that we can then move through from functional definitions through to unselected recruitment approaches that allow us to explore the prevalence of particular profiles and identify groups of interest based on children's profiles. So let me now try to make this a little bit more concrete by talking to you about one particular transdiagnostic study. So this is the Center for Attention, Learning and Memory, has the nice acronym of CALM. I've been involved in this study for the last 8 years. When we set about trying to recruit a sample to study, we had a deliberately broad approach. We tried to ignore diagnoses and instead recruit children who had additional needs in the areas of attention, learning, and memory. And we did this by working in partnership with many health and education practitioners. And we were able to recruit a sample of 805 children. Over half of the sample had no diagnoses, despite coming to the attention of these professionals for having additional needs in these areas. The remainder of the sample had either a single or multiple diagnoses. We carried out a broad range of assessments with these children. We carried out multi-level assessments, so we assessed everything from genes through to brain structure and function, cognition, behavior, learning, and mental health. And where possible, we carried out deep phenotyping. So for example, when it came to cognition, we carried out a number of assessments, tapping into skills and abilities that would be linked to learning outcomes. We didn't tie the selection of any of these measures to any particular theory. We've been able to analyze the data in many different ways, and we've taken different slices through these data to try and understand what it means to be neurodivergent. These analytic approaches are ones that enable us to capture complexity and to handle multivariate data. And I want to talk to you about two of these approaches today. I want to talk to you about a dimensional approach and about a clustering approach. Now, with the dimensional approach, we were able to answer one question, and the clustering approach allowed us to answer a second question. So the first question that we were interested in trying to answer was, what are the cognitive dimensions of learning in a neurodiverse sample? So to do this, we looked at the data from the many cognitive tasks that we'd administered, and we carried out factor analysis to identify the broad dimensions of cognitive skills differentiating our large heterogeneous population. And we then carried out path analysis to look at how these dimensions predicted children's performance on our learning measures assessing reading, spelling, maths, and vocabulary. Now, I'm not going to go into the details of the analysis, but I'm going to present to you the model of the different cognitive dimensions that we were able to identify. So here we have these boxes along the bottom. These correspond to the tasks that we've administered to the children, and they capture children's performance on those tasks. And then we have here our dimensions that we've been able to identify through our factor analysis or latent variable analysis. And you can see here that we've identified a factor that seems to predict and underpin performance on these three tasks. These three tasks all have a heavy verbal or phonological element to them. So we've called this underlying ability phonological processing. We also identified a dimension related to processing speed that seemed to predict performance on this range of tasks. And another dimension we called executive function that predicted performance on this bunch of tasks here that really tapped into working memory and nonverbal reasoning. So we were then interested in looking at how these dimensions, so phonological processing, speed, and executive function, predicted children's learning outcomes. So here I've just flipped that cognitive model on its head just for ease, so that now we can focus on these outcomes here. And we can look at how performance on each of these dimensions or children's underlying latent abilities in these areas predict their learning outcomes. And you can see, hopefully, here that phonological processing was related to children's outcomes in verbal areas of learning, in terms of reading, spelling, and vocabulary. Processing speed was linked to reading. And you can see here that executive function was predictive of children's maths outcomes and more weakly linked to their vocabulary abilities. So using this approach, we've been able to identify that the cognitive dimensions differentiating performance in our neurodiverse sample are very similar to those we might expect in a neurotypical sample. We can also see the ways in which these link to learning are very similar that we might also see to those that we might also see in a neurotypical sample. So now let's move on to the second question. Do diagnoses correspond to behavioural profiles? So to answer this question, we use data from the Parents-Conners rating scale that assesses children's behaviour in terms of attention, hyperactivity and impulsivity, learning problems, executive function, aggression and peer relationships. We were interested in trying to map the relationships between children or identify subgroups of children who had similar ratings across those six subscales. We use network science to do this. So network science allows us to have nodes that would correspond to our data. So in this case, each node corresponds to a child's ratings across those six dimensions. So inattention, hyperactivity, executive function, and so on. And what we can do is then plot the associations between children based on the ratings they have on those six measures. So here you can see that we've plotted the association between child A and child B based on their scores across those rating scales. So we can do this for all the children in the sample, and then we can use cluster analysis to identify subgroups of children who have more similar profiles to one another than to other children in the sample. So here I've just simply plotted the associations between four children, and I've used a clustering algorithm to identify that child C and child D have profiles that are very similar to one another, and then child A and child B have profiles that are very similar to one another, and the children in those clusters are more distinct from the children in the other cluster. So we carried out this type of analysis on the Conners data in the CALM sample. We were able to identify three subgroups or clusters of children. One here, shown in yellow, was characterized by having elevated symptoms of inattention, hyperactivity, and executive function difficulties. The second cluster, shown in blue, was characterized by having elevated aggression and difficulties making and sustaining friendships. And this cluster here in red seemed to have relatively specific difficulties on learning activities. So we were able to map these three subgroups, and then quite importantly, we were able to ask, were any children with a particular diagnosis overrepresented in any particular cluster? So to make that more concrete, we were interested, for example, in saying, well, are all the children with ADHD represented in this yellow cluster that seems to have a profile that would correspond to an ADHD diagnosis? The simple answer to that is no. Children with ADHD were present in all three clusters. And this was true for all the diagnoses that we looked at. Children with particular diagnoses appeared across all three clusters. So this suggests that the symptom profiles in the children in our sample did not necessarily map onto groupings that would correspond to diagnostic status. So let me now briefly summarize what I've talked about today. Hopefully I've highlighted some of the challenges when we're studying neurodiversity. Typically the literature is dominated by studies that have samples that are too small and too selective, and they rely on methods that can't handle complexity and variability. Quite crucially, they seem to fail to capture children who have complex and co-occurring needs or children with milder needs. I've suggested that by using a transdiagnostic approach, we've been encouraged to use broader recruitment strategies that move away from using diagnostic frameworks. We are encouraged to use multi-level assessments with deep phenotyping where possible. And we're also encouraging people to use multivariate methods to try and capture the complexity in the data, which reflects the complexity of trying to understand neurodiversity. Using CALM as an example, I've been able to show that the cognitive dimensions of learning in neurodivergent children are similar to those that we find in neurotypical children. And I've been able to show that symptom presentations do not map onto the criteria that we currently use to both identify and support children's needs. In other words, through using a transdiagnostic approach, we've been able to show that our current diagnostic approaches fail to capture what it is like to be neurodiverse. I'm going to end there. Thank you very much for listening. I'd like to thank my research group and the many people who are involved in the CALM team, these people here who are involved in collecting the data, and quite crucially, my collaborators, Duncan, Tom, Kate, Roger, and Sue. So thank you very much for listening.
Thank you so much, Joni. That was a fantastic talk and got our session off to a great start. I'm going to use my privilege as chair of the session to ask you a question, but just a reminder to everyone watching remotely to please post your questions for Joni if you would like to. So Joni, I think you're showing the sort of limited utility of our diagnostic categories with this work. And I suppose, you know, if the end result is that we change or even abandon our kind of diagnostic categorization process, what would we then replace it with to make sure that people who need help get the help that they need?
That's a really important question. I think it's the burning question that we all have. I think you're right that we need something to replace it, because we do need to be able to identify where people have additional needs, and we need to be able to provide the right kind of support for them. I think when you look at the outcomes from transdiagnostic studies and transdiagnostic research, we're really pointing towards trying to be able to better capture an individual's profile and to use that to identify areas of need. So I think really we're starting to think more about a child-centered approach, and I think we're trying to think much more about how we might, for example, carry out a number of assessments and identify a child's, for example, cognitive profile or behavioural profile. And then we use that information to inform the kind of support and guidance that we would provide.
Mm. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I find that very intuitive. You know, I worry increasingly about the diagnostic process being a sort of branch line where you go off down this kind of side road to get a diagnostic label and then just have to rejoin the main pathway to kind of work out what kind of support someone needs.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So I guess the other part of that is that, you know, as we know, clinical diagnoses are completely central at the moment to unlocking sort of services and so on, but also they have a centrality in terms of people's identity, you know, meeting other people who might have a similar experience to you and so on. We hear a lot talked about this in the kind of autistic community, people who are perhaps diagnosed later in life, sort of finding their tribe, you know. So I wonder if you have any thoughts about, you know, if we lose our diagnostic categories, what that might mean for the sort of emotional experience, I suppose, or the social experience.
I think it's incredibly important. And I think it's one of the biggest challenges when we say, oh, the diagnostic system's not fit for purpose in terms of diagnosing areas of need and support. But of course, we know it's really important for identity. It's also, in the work that I've carried out, it's really important for parents, because if their child has a diagnosis, I think it just helps them to try to understand better that it's, you know, not their fault, there's nothing that they're responsible for. So there is a lot of emotion tied up in the kind of labelling system that we currently use. I think it's important that we recognise that, and that moving forward, if we're starting to think about a new system that might identify need, that might then become the language that we use around areas of need, that might then help people to come together around areas of need, so that we don't attach as much to a label, but it becomes more about areas of need or sets of symptoms, for example, that people can say, well, I share these symptoms with people and therefore I can, you know, kind of unite with those people. But I think it's a huge challenge.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. But I mean, I think, yeah, my experience, you know, there's already kind of subsets in the autistic community who perhaps also have a diagnosis of ADHD and are reaching out to other people with that particular combination and so on. And you know, that's what we're all looking for, is finding someone mm-hmm. like us in a way that goes beyond these labels and goes into something more deeper about our experience. So yeah, I think that makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, sorry, carry on, Sue.
Well, I just wanted to point out, we do still have 5 more minutes before we need to move on to the next speaker. And so I would like to encourage people to post up questions, because we've got time to hear more from Joni. But I just wanted to ask as well about, you know, the sort of practicalities for teachers. You know, we know that professionals in the education system are feeling very overwhelmed a lot of the time. Schools can be often quite under-resourced. And it feels like there are sort of more kids in the classroom with additional needs than there used to be. So I wonder what you would say, you know, what are your thoughts on a practical level in terms of what we can be doing in the education system to support young people?
I think this is really good. I mean, I think you've hit the nail on the head, really, in saying, you know, what can we do in the classroom to support young people, and that there might be more children who need additional support. And I think it is about training teachers up, making teachers aware, making the classroom more inclusive. So just creating greater awareness. But in my experience, when you speak to teachers and educational professionals, they've been aware there've been many children with a whole variety of needs in the classroom for a very long time. And actually, they often have already got the skills needed to support many children. But I do think there's an element of having to reframe so the classroom, if you like, to make it more inclusive. There's probably a real need to start to train teachers specifically around these ideas of, you know, complex profiles of need and kind of individual support that might be needed for particular children. But it's a huge challenge. I think this is the biggest problem with the transdiagnostic approach. I think all the questions you've asked touch upon this issue of how do we bring about systemic change, which is kind of what we need, right?
Yeah, completely agree. One last question, I think, before we moved on. This is from Lene Buckle, who is asking, how do you decide which characteristics are important to investigate in a study like CALM? So she mentions language, attention, why not other difficulties like maths or social skills?
That's a really good question. And I think when you're thinking about a transdiagnostic study, you know, you can't assess everything just from practical reasons that, you know, you haven't got endless amounts of time. In our particular case, we were really interested in looking at children's learning outcomes. So we included maths and reading, vocabulary, spelling, assessments like this. And then we looked at all of the likely cognitive measures or candidates that might be related to learning outcomes in those areas. And that's what we based the selection of our sort of cognitive tasks upon. We did have some other measures that I didn't go into today in terms of in this talk, but really, I think it was about thinking about what is it we're interested in terms of outcomes, and then looking across the literature at the you know, trying to encompass as many likely measures that might be related to those outcomes. So that's how we based our choice of tasks. But I know there's other studies that are going on, sort of particularly there's one in Cardiff where they're very interested in children's behaviour. They focus much more on the social end of assessments, looking at behavioural outcomes. So I think in these studies, you know, we necessarily have to be a bit selective, just from practical reasons, but I think looking at trying to encompass as much as possible that's related to your outcomes is the way to really approach these studies.
Amazing. Thank you so much, Joni. It was brilliant to hear from you. And that is a great place to set us up for the next speaker, who is Rachel Maina from Aga Khan University in Kenya. And she is doing the first of our Data Blitz talks in this session. And she's going to be presenting a narrative review of measures of neuropsychological function for children. So really excited to hear Rachel's data.
So I'm going to speak to give a narrative review of a test, neuropsychological tests for middle childhood and also their psychometric properties. So it's first important to notice that a significant number of neuropsychological measures for use among children aged 6 to 12 years have been adapted or developed in high-income countries. However, we really can't just pick up those tools and implement them within low and middle-income countries, because there's different cultural constructs that are captured within low and middle-income countries compared to high-income countries. So it is important to adapt them when we before we implement them in low and middle income countries so as to minimize bias. However, this is rarely done, and we want to show the extent of this. So we carried out a narrative review to identify tools that are commonly used, as well as to summarize the psychometric properties. We did this by searching literature for tests that were adapted, developed, standardized between 1987 and 2017. And most of the keywords that we use were neuropsychological or neurocognitive, as well as assessment. So out of 306, we had 145 papers that reported on psychometric properties of different tools. Most of the papers reported on the BRAVE tool, which had like a count of 6 papers, the visual motor integration, test of memory malingering, MSBT, as well as continuous performance test. So we also found out that most of these tests were developed and adapted from United States of America, which further points to a lack of validated measures for low and middle income countries. We also found out that most of the tests are either measuring executive function or complex attention, which again points to a lack of validity within other cognitive domains. And then we also noticed that most of the studies address certain aspects of validity or reliability while leaving out others. We found out like when a test probably would be tested for test retest, they probably not have internal consistency, or when it comes to validity, they probably report on convergent validity or discriminant validity or construct validity. So it wasn't very comprehensive when it. So as you can see in pictures, like most of the tools were from United States, Canada, and we found out like these other countries had like one paper, like Argentina, Australia, Bangalore. They had one paper for each. Then when you look at the cognitive domains distribution, we had memory, complex attention, and executive function. So again, in low and middle income countries, we can see like this is a display of which countries had the most tools that were adapted. So we have like in Kenya, the executive function test, complex attention test, and perception motor and motor test, all those domains were captured. But you can see like most of the countries had either one domain captured. So again, you'd wonder if they do measure cognitive functioning in children, especially among those ones age 6 to 12 years, which tools are they using, and are they capturing constructs that are specific to that particular context. We propose further studies to thoroughly investigate and report the psychometric properties of these measures, especially in low and middle income countries. And I want to acknowledge the various funding I received for this particular project. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Rachel. That was a fantastic presentation and quite a monstrous piece of work you undertook there. So I'm very impressed by your efforts. I wonder if you could tell me, you know, when we're looking at choosing measures for research, often it's very hard to find the perfect measure with all of the psychometric properties we might want. Which of the psychometric properties would you say is a kind of priority when you're selecting measures? Which is the most important factor, and why would that be?
Okay, so thank you for that particular question. So what I found out, especially when I'm implementing, when I'm using a tool in the clinic, it's very important to look not only at one or two, but all significant analytical measures. For example, when you decide to just look at convergent validity, that is checking whether a tool that probably measures social skills correlates well with another that measures social skills, you may probably get that the tool is actually really good, it has good correlation measures. But when you check, but if you don't check on this validity, that means that the tool can be able to not capture a certain construct, like probably interpersonal skills, which is closely related to social skills, and you decide not to choose that, and yet it captures that, then you might actually be diagnosing someone or a child for something that they do not have. So I wouldn't recommend for someone to just check convergent validity and say, oh, it has really good p-values, so let's go with it. I'll probably just check on this validity and say, oh, it actually doesn't capture other variables, other constructs, apart from the one I'm interested in, so that is really good. I would advocate for someone to choose one tool that has good psychometric properties, of course, when it comes to reliability, when it comes to validity. In my presentation, I wanted to give people, because I know people do not have much time to go into tools and look at which one works for them, but they already know which problems they want to check. Like if they find a child is learning slow, they'd like to check on their processing speed. So with the narrative review, I wanted to give them like a sort of a very a shortcut to which tool they can use and whether they can use in their context. That's why I probably spoke about the brief, which is an executive function tool and has really good psychometric properties across board, instead of running for just one that has just one psychometric property. So, yeah.
Thank you so much, Rachel. Well, as I say, a really impressive piece of work. And I saw a link there on your slide to where people can look for more details about the measures that you evaluated. So that's fantastic. We will have to move on now to our next speaker, which is our basic science talk for the session. This is being delivered by Danyal Akarca from the MRC Cognition and Brain Sciences Unit in Cambridge. And he's going to be talking about how we can use generative models to understand neurodevelopmental diversity.
Thank you very much for coming to the session. My name is Danyal Akarca. I'm a medic by training. Currently doing my PhD research at the Cognition and Brain Sciences Unit at the University of Cambridge. And it's a pleasure to be giving the basic science talk today in the neurodevelopmental diversity session. And I'm going to be talking about generative modelling of neurodevelopmental diversity. So we'll go straight ahead. First, I'm going to be talking about neurodevelopmental diversity, specifically relating to brain networks. Then move on to what generative modelling is and why I think it's interesting, before going on to some findings relating to simulating variability between individuals at the macro and micro scale, and before I summarise my findings in the short amount of time I have. So firstly, neurodevelopmental diversity and generative modelling. So I'm going to be talking predominantly about brains as networks. And when we think about differences between individuals at the level of the brain, we often have questions surrounding brain organization. And one way that we can do this is via an approach called tractography. Tractography is effectively derived from diffusion tensor imaging from MRI. And this can actually help us non-invasively understand some of the white matter architecture of the brain and the networks that it forms within the brain. From this, we can actually form what's called an adjacency matrix, where you have rows and columns which correspond to something called the structural connectivity network, which is on the right. And from this structural connectivity network, we actually now have a graph of the networks within the brain. So a schematic is here, and what they reflect is at the node level, so the circles, are, for example, cortical gray matter. And the edges, or the black lines, are, for example, white matter integrity. And you can utilize something called graph theory to actually describe the network topology. So we can actually now, for every individual, describe the different types of networks that are within the brain. So that's the basis. But then we have this other thing that I've mentioned called generative models. And what are they? So just for a moment, I want you just to look at this fairly complicated image and think about how it came to be. And you'll realize quite quickly that it's a little bit of a silly question because you have no idea how this image was generated. All you can really do is describe what you see rather than actually explain how it came to be. And the reason why I think this is interesting is because actually it's very simple. It's just a canvas that's on the floor that someone's taken a pendulum with some paint on, pushed the paint, and then as the energy dissipates, the paint actually kind of moves towards the center and forms this really nice image. And the reason I think this is quite nice is because now we actually can see that this complexity that we have has arisen from relative simplicity just over time. And this is also quite nice because we actually have some very basic, relatively basic mathematics that can describe how this complex image was generated. Using basic trigonometry and Newton's laws of motion. And so in some sense, this simple mathematical equation is a generative model for the complex image that I've just shown you. So why is this relevant? Well, actually, I'm going to be talking about something called generative network models, where we actually can bridge this idea of generative models to explain how complexity arose, but also think about networks in the brain as well. And this is important because many accounts of neurodevelopment are pretty descriptive. And I'm aware of none really that are computationally formalized, so they can tell you the mathematics about how the complexity between individuals has arisen over time. And this is crucial if we want to think about how differences occur between people throughout development at the level of the brain. And so this is what I'm going to be talking about. And one of the questions that have motivated my research is this question of if there is a simple, biologically plausible or realistic generative model that can actually simulate neurodiversity. So that's a very quick introduction into what motivates this kind of study of neurodevelopmental diversity, networks in the brain, and utilizing this thing called generative models to be able to simulate these networks. But what kind of findings do we get? So I'm going to just explain the basis for these models. And they utilize this principle called the wiring economy. And it's very straightforward, actually. It's just this idea that if you have networks in the brain, which we think there are, that the organization of these brain networks must be constrained by finite resources. And what that means really is that when the brain is forming these complex networks, then there must be a balance between minimizing wiring costs whilst maximizing connection value. So this continual trade-off is really important in development in ensuring that we're forming and maintaining connections correctly over time. So if you just follow me through this this logic, we can actually form what's called a wiring equation. So imagine that you have two regions of the brain, and I have them as schematics of neurons here, I and J, and there may be a cost between them wiring. So we call that D, which might be the distance. So if it's very far away, that's quite costly. But if it's very close, it's actually quite easy to connect. Versus value, which is in K. And whatever the value is between those two that's conferring that they should wire with each other. So it's basically a drive for and against wiring. And together, you can basically have this simple equation which says that the probability that they will wire, Pij, is proportional to the costs, Dij, times the values, Kij. So it's effectively the balance between the costs and the values. And we have this additional Greek letter that's next to each of these, which is telling you how much costs and how much values contributes to this wiring probability. And that's called eta for costs and gamma for values. And I'll come back to that in a moment. The reason why this super simple kind of model is nice is because it can actually explain some basic principles in development. So early on in development, when you can imagine maybe as a neonate, you don't have many connections, or as many connections at least as later on. And as a result of this, you actually might find that space is what drives it, because value, you don't really know what's valuable to each area. So for example, node 2 and node 36, you can see here, they're more likely to connect because they're really close to each other. And you can see that from the little bar charts on the right. The distance is really low, so the wiring probability is very high. But later in development, you get this other pattern that you find, simply based on the equation, which is that actually, because now you have edge connections within the network, you actually might find that even if the cyan connection here is really close to 2 to 27, actually, because the red connection is much, much, much more valuable to 2, it would rather wire with, make the red connection rather than the cyan connection. And so you find this kind of non-linearity of how networks can form. This has another nice phenomena that occurs, where you can actually now add a connection. So on the left compared to the right, we've just added an amber connection. But the wiring probability matrix, the colors underneath, have changed quite a lot. So it's almost like if you form one connection, now there are a whole host of new connections that you might want to form as a result of a single connection happening, which is basically to show that it's quite unpredictable how you may an individual network may develop over time. And so how does this work? Well, we can actually simulate network wiring. And I can see that G has just cut off, but that's okay. So we want to simulate network wiring. And the way that we do this is that we have this equation, and we can actually simulate the network developing over time. So we can now think about this brain network, for example, of a little child developing into an adult brain. And what we do is we've simulated that in the computer, but now what we do is actually take T1 and diffusion scans from MRI of real people, now not on the computer, and we take the observations. And then what we do is actually then make a comparison between our simulation and our observation, and we compute what's called a cost function, or in this term, we call it the energy. And effectively, what we want to do is say we want as small a difference as possible. So the question is, what wiring rules produce low energy simulated networks? And what we find is that if you look at a load of different models, you find there's this one rule that tends to do very well called homophily. And so you can see here that's the lower the better, which is why I'm highlighting it. And effectively, homophily is this idea that you wire based on similar neighborhood structure, which basically is to say that you wire with things that are similar to yourself. It's actually a macroscopic manifestation of something that we've heard a lot of, probably, is Hebb's rule. So Hebb's rule is wire together, homophily is this idea that you're wiring something similar to yourself. And why this is really nice from a neurodevelopmental perspective is that actually now we can look at where variability exists. So what is it that drives the differences between children? And if you look in the space of all possible brains, you can see in that really dark area is a small window of plausible brains. And we think this is because of the tightly regulated nature of developments. And each of the crosses on the right is telling you an individual child's brain. So if I could take that coordinate on the right, you could pop it into an equation, and it can simulate the network development of that child's brain. And we've done this for 270 children from a cohort of children called CALM, Center for Attention, Learning and Memory. These children have wide-ranging cognitive problems, but actually they're very diverse in their nature. And so intersect with lots of different types of diagnoses like autism and ADHD. We find actually that utilizing this approach, you can predict the cognitive scores of these children from the model using something called partial least squares regression, which is a machine learning technique. So we can measure, we can predict, for example, their maths and reading abilities. We also find some interesting findings relating to spatial embedding. So even though this model is quite simple, we actually have shown that we can recapitulate a few of different phenomena in the brain, such as where the hub nodes are. So where the really concentrated connectivity is in the brain, you can actually find this in the simulations in the computer. And finally, through quite an interesting analysis, we have data on gene expression in the brain. And so what we have is, what we've done is actually compare where genes are expressed with the simulations, and we find that the Kij bits, when you see here parameterized values, the Kij part of the simulation correlates really nicely with genes that are important for synaptic signaling and neuronal projection. So we have this idea that this idea of homophily, which is a manifestation of Hebbian learning, actually relates directly to genes important at the level of the synapse. So I know I don't have much left, but we can actually look at different scales. So I've spoken so far about MRI, but we have data at the level of individual neurons that have been grown on a plate. So what you can see here is an electron microscope image of neurons actually developing on a dish, which are being recorded for their electrical activity. And the question that we actually have is, just like before, we can actually model these networks just like what I've done so far. So we have these developing neuronal networks that can develop over the course of 7, 14, 21, 28 days, and actually see at this kind of level of analysis if we find the similar findings. Of course, this is really interesting because now we're bridging different scales and to be able to think about neurodevelopmental diversity in the broadest sense possible. And so what we find is this idea of homophily also works and operates fairly nicely at these levels as well. So for those of you who could see the previous slide where I showed the generative models, you can see that the energy, which is this cost function, is low also in these networks, which is really nice because it gives us some sort of consistent explanation across scales. So I've gone through quite a lot, but I'd just like to summarize the findings so far. It's my view really that computational modeling, like what I've described, can really help us answer questions about developmental differences, and possibly much more than just describing what we see. We can actually explain why we're getting differences between individuals. I think probably thinking about how the economical trade-offs in the brain in terms of costs and values, I think, is probably very important, particularly with relation to this idea of homophily. And this seems to be conserved across scales. So it's quite nice that actually at multiple levels of analysis of the brain, we can see this. And specifically for questions on neurodevelopmental diversity, brain network structure can be considered within this kind of window of plausible brains in which we vary within this window. I'd just like to acknowledge some fantastic collaborators in my team, our team at the in the lab. So my supervisor, Duncan Astall, the CALM team, Petra Vertes, Professor Ed Bullmore, Professor Salu Fletcher-Watson, Professor John Duncan, Yasha Ashterberg, but also our collaborators in physiology in Cambridge, at Harvard University, and recent collaborators at Google DeepMind as well. My funders, the MRC, Cambridge Trust, and JSMF. We've published a paper recently on this topic if you're interested in nature communications. And thank you very much for listening. And I'll be happy to take any questions.
Thank you so much, Dan. That was a characteristically fascinating and a little bit intimidating talk, at least from my point of view. So just a reminder to everyone watching, if you've got questions, please do put them in the question box and I can pass them on to Dan. But I will start by asking, so Joni Holmes in our first talk in this session talked about how transdiagnostic methods can help us explore sort of multiple different causes of the same potential cognitive outcome. Could these generative models also contribute to that kind of investigation, do you think?
Yeah, so I guess the key idea that Joni mentioned previously was that we had quite simplistic models previously where you kind of have one cause and one outcome. And that I guess the main motif there is really trying to embrace the complexity that actually you can have many different causes to different outcomes, a kind of a many-to-many relationship kind of thing. And I guess one of the main ideas of this kind of computational modeling is that it can deal with the complexity. So it can you can have situations within these models where you can have similar starting points, for example, and then you end up having quite different outcomes. And also you can have different outcomes that are derived from very similar, from similar starting points. So different starting point, same outcome, or same at the starting point, different outcomes. And you can relate that those parameters of those models directly to cognition, which I mentioned previously. I have to kind of stress, though, that this, what I've discussed here, is specifically about kind of, you know, brain network structures, for example. So we didn't take into account, you know, the kind of complexity of someone's cognitive profile directly or anything like that. You know, to really be able to map out the cause and effect of different, you know, causes and outcomes, you'd have to kind of do a bit more of a different type of analysis, I think. But there's a lot of the ingredients around those kind of questions, I think, can be increasingly answered by these types of modeling techniques, for sure.
And so you said at the end there that, you know, you think this approach offers more than just description. And one of the reasons why we want to do more than just describe is that if we can understand mechanisms and causes and so on, then we can start to make a difference for people, identify things that are problems in their lives and help with those problems. Can you see a pathway from this very kind of technical basic science to practical application? What does that pathway look like?
Yeah, it's a really good question. So I guess the nature of the type of work that I kind of presented today is that it's really trying to condense the complexity into something that's a little bit more tractable. So, you know, at the moment, because it's complicated, we do just, we generally describe what we see, a bit like that photo that I was telling you before. And the idea behind this in principle is that we're trying to condense that complexity so that actually individuals can understand and embrace that a little bit better. It's a little bit more understandable if you have a space of, you know, this is the range of normality that exists. And it's very, very normal for individuals to live on that space of differences. And yeah, and I think that is, you know, philosophically, you know, a bit nicer than actually just describing the differences, because you actually now have a little bit of an understanding that it's very normal from a, you know, scientific perspective as well, how and why we would get these differences. It's nothing intrinsic, you know, it's just, this is the typical way in which differences would emerge anyway, you know. So I'm not sure if that completely answers your question. I'd probably need a little bit longer, but I think, yeah, the kind of compression, you know, kind of taking the complexity and simplifying it is the key essence of this.
Yeah. No, I love that philosophical point. I mean, I think that's really, you know, a beautiful fit with the kind of neurodiversity approach, which is, I'm a big fan of at the moment. But we must briskly move on to our second Data Blitz talk. Thank you so much, Dan. That was fantastic. We are now going to hear from Richard Cole from the National Hospital for Neurology and Neurosurgery, who is going to talk about the presence of autistic and alexithymic traits in people with functional neurological symptom disorder.
This study looks at the prevalence of autistic traits and alexithymia in an outpatient FND program. And just to recap on FND, we know it's a multi-network disorder where neurological symptoms are incompatible with known pathology, and it's associated with network disturbances involved in attention, self-agency, interoception, and emotion and threat processing. Alexithymia is a construct referring to difficulty in identifying and describing emotions. In terms of what we aim to do, as well as report on the prevalence of autistic traits and alexithymia, we also wanted to look at whether they were associated with increased symptoms of depression, anxiety, social phobia, and somatic symptom severity. And one of the reasons for this is that differences in interoception and sensory and emotional processing are common to both FND and autism, as are higher rates of alexithymia. We also felt that undiagnosed autism may add or increase vulnerability to stressors which could precipitate or perpetuate FND. So 91 patients in the outpatient FND program completed self-report measures of autistic traits, alexithymia, generalized anxiety, depression, social phobia, and somatic symptom severity. We found that 40% of the group scored 6 or above on the AQ-10, which is a clinical cutoff to warrant further assessment for autism, and 40% scored in the alexithymic range. Then when we divided the group between those scoring 6 or above on the AQ-10 versus those scoring below, we found that the group with the higher number of autistic traits reported significantly higher levels of alexithymia, generalized anxiety, depression, and social phobia. When we compared those with or without alexithymia, we found that those with alexithymia reported significantly higher numbers of autistic traits, as well as degrees of anxiety, depression, social phobia, and somatic symptom severity. So we report new evidence of a high prevalence of autistic traits in an outpatient adult FND group, and further evidence of a high prevalence of alexithymia. Both of these were associated with symptoms of anxiety, depression, and social phobia. Clinically, measures of autistic traits and alexithymia could be important in the management of FND, as if the higher number of autistic traits translates into a higher prevalence of autism, then an adapted communication style would be important to consider within the MDT approach, where communication is a key part of CBT, occupational and physiotherapy. It would be important to consider carefully how to relay these findings to someone with FND, especially in a therapeutic context, and also especially considering a higher degree of anxiety and depression, as an additional diagnosis could add more stress. Mechanistically, this study offers a limited insight, but alexithymia, which has been reported to be prevalent in 50% of people with autism, has been associated with impaired interoception, which is an important etiological factor to consider in FND. Future research could explore what mediates this relationship through gathering interoceptive data, and it would also be important to look at outcomes of an FND program, compare between those with higher or lower number of autistic traits.
That was absolutely fascinating, Richard. Thank you so much for that lovely talk. So I have to ask, why do you think you might be seeing these higher autistic traits and alexithymic traits in people with FND?
It's quite hard to say from this study, because we didn't really assess the mechanisms, and we, you know, we can't really say the participants were autistic, just that they had a high number of traits. But it's probably multifactorial and maybe relates to what Mark Edwards was saying earlier. So people with autistic traits might be more sensitive to novel sensory stimuli. There could be more cognitive and affective biases that underlie it. But it could also at the same time be more so alexithymia. That's important here, because we know alexithymia isn't universal to people with autism. It's just quite common in autism. And so it'd be interesting to see if you had people with autism and alexithymia and compared number of functional symptoms in that group compared to those with just autism without alexithymia. But it could also just be more of a kind of psychosocial level, where people living with autism, especially if it's undiagnosed, it could be quite stressful living in a neurotypical world, could be more vulnerable to things like trauma because of theory of mind differences. It's probably lots of different things could be at play there. But yeah, it'd be interesting to look into the mechanisms.
Yeah, absolutely. And then just quickly, in terms of practical significance, I mean, you talked about, for example, potentially adapting communication in services for people with FND if there are is higher prevalence of autism in that group as well. How, you know, I'm an autism researcher and I'm really acutely aware of the high rates of co-occurrence between autism and other diagnoses, mental health conditions, things like ADHD. Hypermobility and so on. And I sometimes think, goodness me, every single medical professional is going to have to end up being an autism expert to do their job, which seems difficult to achieve. And I just wondered if you had any thoughts as a clinician on, you know, how we can sort of upskill people about all of these co-occurrences that are being kind of revealed by transdiagnostic work.
Yeah, I think that's really important. And I mean, I can answer it from a kind of psychiatry core trainee perspective. Where I actually kind of feel like all psychiatry core trainees should be more expert on neurodevelopmental differences, just as much as they are on schizophrenia or bipolar, for example. But I think one of the difficult things is that most core trainees get their neurodevelopmental kind of skills or learning within CAMS jobs, and for obvious reasons, but lots of trainees don't really do CAMS jobs. It's not essential now. And so it might mean that people who in kind of adult psychiatry, they might miss neurodevelopmental differences, or it might not be at the forefront of their mind, you know, if they don't look for it, don't see it. And especially with the problem of diagnostic overshadowing from personality disorders, could mask it even more. So I think it definitely highlights that trainees should be more aware of it, definitely in adult psychiatry, and they should be making more of an effort to keep up with kind of the neurodiversity movement that is certainly very relevant in the general population, not just within clinicians. So there's definitely a need for it.
Brilliant. Thank you so much, Richard. Well, I could stay and talk for ages, but we need to move on to our final presentation. Definitely last but not least, we're going to hear from Beth Tekola from King's College London about work that she carried out in Ethiopia on autism, parenting and stigma.
Hello, everyone. My name is Bethlehem Tekola. The title of my presentation is Autism, Parenting and Stigma, Perspectives from Ethiopia. I have organized my presentation into four sections. First, I'll give you a bit of background information about Ethiopia in general and the situation regarding autism in the country. Then I will talk about shared needs and experiences among parents of children with developmental disabilities in Ethiopia, particularly focusing on their stigma experiences. Then I will discuss the World Health Organization Caregivers Skills Training Program in Ethiopia. Here, I will show you how parents of children with a wide range of developmental disabilities found the training helpful. Finally, I will briefly talk about lessons learned. Ethiopia is located in the Horn of Africa. It is the second most populous country in Africa after Nigeria, with a total population of over 104 million people. About half of the population are children. 85% of the population lives in rural areas where agriculture is the main source of livelihood. We don't know the exact prevalence of autism and intellectual disability in Ethiopia, and this is generally the case for Africa. There are limited health and educational services for children with developmental disabilities in Ethiopia, and the available services are restricted to the capital city, Addis Ababa, and therefore not accessible to the majority of the population living in rural areas. There is shortage of trained people, especially in rural areas. For example, currently, there is only one formally qualified child psychiatrist in the country. There is a lack of knowledge and awareness about autism, both among the general public as well as health professionals. Often, autism and intellectual disability are not identified. And in addition to these challenges, there is a high level of stigma and misconceptions about causes of developmental disabilities, which are often associated with being cursed or being possessed by evil spirits. My talk on shared needs and experiences among parents, specifically about their stigma experiences, will be based on our paper, which was published in Social Science Medicine in 2020. The aim of our study was to explore perceptions and experiences of stigma among parents of children with developmental disabilities in rural and urban Ethiopia. We used in-depth interviews. We interviewed 40 mothers and 4 fathers, in total 18 parents, in Addis Ababa and the rural town of Butajira. We used thematic analysis to analyze the data. In terms of children diagnosis, 40 children had a formal clinical diagnosis of intellectual disability. 6 children had autism as primary diagnosis. 2 of these children had a comorbid formal diagnosis of intellectual disability, but the other 4 autistic children also had some degree of general developmental delay. And the children were aged between 4 and 9 years. The parents we interviewed perceived and experienced different forms of stigma. One form of stigma that they mentioned was a stigma directed towards their child. In talking about stigma directed towards their child, parents said they mentioned about stereotypes that people held about their child. For example, seeing their child as dangerous, seeing their child as a threat to other children's safety, and also talked about how their child was not allowed to play with other children, how they were excluded. A mother of a 7-year-old girl with intellectual disability in Addis Ababa, for example, said, "I'm living in a community which does not understand you. My daughter, for example, fears fight. She is calm and doesn't touch anyone, and she also doesn't want to be touched by others. But the community sees her in another way. They think that she will hit and push their children. There is exclusion." The other form of stigma that the parents mentioned was stigma directed towards themselves. Here they talked about how they were blamed for their child's disability, and they also talked about how they were excluded from social life, not only by the general public, but also sometimes by their own parents, I mean, by their own families. A mother of a 9-year-old boy with intellectual disability in Butajira said, "The attitude of other people, because my child can listen but cannot talk, they say, 'Why doesn't your child talk?' My neighbors used to say, 'My child is Duda, tongue-tied.' They were saying, 'Did you give birth to a Duda?' They were teasing me. They were making fun of me, saying her oldest child is like this. They were saying I must have done something to cause the child's disability. They were saying all of this in my presence, but I used to pretend that I was not listening, but cry when I got home." Some of the parents isolated themselves and their child from social life. This is because to protect themselves from the impact of stigma. And sometimes if they experienced stigma in the past, they fear the prospect of stigma. So they isolate themselves and their child from social life. A mother of a 7-year-old girl with intellectual disability in Addis Ababa said, "The awareness level of the community is very low and a lot needs to be done. They don't share their thought with you. They talk about you behind your back, and because of that, you will be forced to exclude yourself from them. That is because we are not living with educated people. They believe in the curse and they give different explanations. Due to this, and to protect your mind, you will exclude yourself. It has a huge impact. It's very difficult." In another study, which involved 102 caregivers of children with developmental disabilities, that is, parents of children, parents of autistic children, as well as parents of children with intellectual disability. Most of them said they reported experiences of stigma, and stigma did not depend on the type of developmental disability. That means both parents of autistic children as well as parents of children with intellectual disability said they experienced stigma. Now I will briefly talk about the World Health Organization caregiver skills training program. Here, as I said earlier, I want to show you how parents of children with a wide range of developmental disabilities found the training helpful. The World Health Organization has developed a caregivers skill training program for caregivers of children with developmental disabilities, including intellectual disability and autism. The training teaches caregivers strategies to support their child's development, learning, and to improve their well-being. The CSD can be delivered by non-specialists, such as community health workers and teachers. It does not require an expert diagnosis of DD. It comprises 9 group sessions and 3 home visits. As part of adapting the training to the Ethiopian context, we conducted a number of consultations with stakeholders. One of this consultation is stakeholder meetings, which we conducted with local psychologists, local psychiatrists, representatives from non-governmental organizations, and parents of children with developmental disabilities. We also conducted theory of change workshops, both in Addis Ababa, the capital city of Ethiopia, and the rural town of Butajira. Here, I would like to show you how some of the parents found the training relevant, acceptable, and beneficial for their situation. Here, a mother of a 5-year-old autistic boy in Addis Ababa, for example, said, "I didn't expect that they, the CST team, will know what we were feeling deep down, and they would present it to us in the lessons. I did not know that they knew what we were feeling inside. I came here just to check it out. When I took one class, I saw a lot of the things that were in my life. All of the problems I had at home were written down in this book." Here, a mother of a 7-year-old boy with intellectual disability in Addis Ababa talked about the benefits of the training for her situation. She said, "Now I'm mixing up with people. Previously, I did not mix up with people. I did not mix up with anybody. I used to lock my door and stay at home and only open the door when my children come home from school. I'm good now because they, CST facilitators, are encouraging me when they come home, when they come for the home visits." Her feeling was shared by another parent. That is a mother of a 9-year-old boy with intellectual disability in Addis Ababa, who said, "After we took part in the training, we have changed a lot. I was hopeless. I used to think that my child cannot mix with other people. Now my child has come out and I also came out. Many people have seen us. We met with many parents. We shared with each other our pains and many other things. And I believe we are going to bring about many changes." Finally, I'll briefly discuss the lessons learned. First, in low resource settings, such as Ethiopia, a task sharing approach is a more practical way to scale up services. Task sharing is a process which tasks are dedicated to less specialized workers, that is, those with little or no formal training. Example, community health workers, teachers. This would help to use the limited human resources in a more efficient way. So the task sharing approach is helpful for in low and middle income countries such as Ethiopia. The World Health Organization Caregivers Skill Training Program is an example of a task sharing approach because it was designed to be delivered by non-specialists. So it can be provided at a low cost to a large group of families. Transdiagnostic approach that cut across different type of developmental disabilities in raw resource settings may further help to scale up services. The works that I presented here today are a team effort, so I would like to thank my colleagues at Addis Ababa University in Ethiopia, as well as at King's College London in the UK. And also I would like to thank institutions which supported these studies financially. Thank you very much.
That was a brilliant presentation from Beth Tekola. Unfortunately, she's not able to be here herself, but we are very lucky to have Melissa Washington-Naughty here, who is a colleague of Beth's. So welcome, Melissa. Thank you for coming along.
Thank you for having me. I'm glad to stand in for Beth.
Now, we don't have a ton of time for loads of questions, but I am going to sneak one in before we finish the session. This piece of work that Beth just presented mostly focused on kind of autism and intellectual disability, but obviously we've been talking about, you know, transdiagnostic research. So I wondered, is it your feeling that the relevance of what Beth was speaking about, you know, the experiences of stigma and the applications of things like the WHO caregiver skills program are relevant across multiple diagnostic categories? Or do we need to be providing more targeted support that differentiates between diagnoses?
I think that you hit the nail on the head. It's really helpful for these diagnostic categories, and that when we're dealing with children with developmental disabilities, just like the World Health Organization's Caregiver Skills Training Program targets children with multiple disabilities, such approaches are very helpful because then they can address the needs of not just one child or not just a particular group of children, but children who have many different either comorbidities or different disabilities. And so a transdiagnostic approach is very, very relevant for the African context.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Melissa. And just briefly then, do you think that there should be a focus in countries like Ethiopia on creating more diagnostic services with the kind of clinical expertise that implies? Or should we sort of be skipping the diagnostic step and just going straight to, there's a problem, let's provide some support? Can we do that?
That's an interesting question. And it reminds me of what Joni shared in her presentation, because in her presentation, she mentioned that they started with a diagnosis, and then they went on to address the symptoms and strategies that could help these children. And so I think the same thing applies in an African context. It's important for people to know exactly what is going on. Sometimes the ambiguity can be very challenging, at least if you know that you have a name for what is going on, and then you can try to address the particular concerns. It even helps at a community level, because as Beth shared in her presentation, stigma is a huge issue. And most of the issues around stigma exist because of lack of knowledge. And so if nobody really can explain what is going on with a particular child and bring some clarity to the situation, it's more difficult to address issues related to stigma. And so I think that the diagnostic process is still very important. And then after that, perhaps we can deal with the strategies to address what is going on. Yeah.
Brilliant, Melissa. Thank you very much for setting me straight. So we have to now finish our session. We've gone 2 minutes over, but I hope I won't be in big, big trouble because it is coming to the end of the day. I believe that there is a poster session available for anyone who wants to go and see it. I'd love to thank all of our amazing speakers who have all brought such innovative and fascinating takes to this session on neurodevelopmental diversity. And thank you to everyone at the Brain Conference for inviting me to chair this session. And thank you everyone at home or wherever you are for listening.